Dear colleagues, it's a pleasure to be here in front of you to discuss about evidence-based medicine and about the Cochrane collaboration. A rapid outline of my talk, I will first discuss the concept of evidence-based medicine, the main sources of evidence used in health, randomized controlled trials, systematic review and meta-analysis, the limits of these sources, our attempts to overcome the limitation of these sources, and a few words about the organization of the production of evidence with an example of the Cochrane collaboration. In fact, in healthcare, we have to make decisions. Physicians must make hundreds of decisions every day. What labs or imaging to order, which treatment to give to the patient, which monitoring for chronic disease. We have a lot of decisions to make. Policymakers must take daily decisions on the organization of care, the reimbursement of treatments, and so on. And these decisions may have major human and financial consequences. And we have developed evidence-based approaches to decision-making. Evidence-based medicine, that is defined as a consensus, explicit, and judicious use of the current best evidence in making decisions about the care of individual patients. This concept was introduced in the 90s at McMaster University and is considered as a milestone in research methods in medicine. And we have also evidence-based public health, that is a consensus, explicit, and judicious use of current best evidence in making decisions about the care of communities and population in the domains of health protection, disease prevention. Traditionally, there are steps in practicing evidence-based medicine. We have first to convert the need for information into an answerable question. We have to track down the best evidence with which to answer that question. We have to critically appraise the evidence for its validity, impact, and applicability, and to integrate the evidence with our clinical expertise and our patient characteristics and values. In fact, there is a classical triad in evidence-based medicine, the best available evidence, but also the patient and population needs for or expectation and the resources and practitioner expertise. And the evidence-based decision-making take into account these three pillars. In fact, one of our big problems, as previously said by Professor Bach, is the quantity of information. It was quite easy when we have only the Journal des Savants in 1667, a few months before the Philosophical Transaction. There was only two journals in the world, but now we have a paper mountain. If you were to print out just the first page of every item indexed in Web of Science, the stack of paper would reach almost the top of Mount Kilimanjaro. Therefore, we have to deal with that. We have a massive volume of medical research. We have in the major database that is called Medline, 4,800 biomedical journals, 30 million articles, and there is 400,000 new articles added each year in this database. The clinical knowledge is estimated to double every 24 months, with new medical procedures emerging every day. And we know that delaying decision-making could have huge evidence consequences. Therefore, a major issue for us is to translate evidence into practice as soon as the evidence is available, and it's clearly a major issue. In the field of health, we use as best evidence mainly randomized controlled trials. We like double-blind randomized controlled trials that are considered as a gold standard to evaluate intervention, and we use systematic review and meta-analysis of randomized controlled trials. In fact, we use randomized controlled trials because there is many factors that may explain the response to a treatment. The response to a treatment could be explained by the patient characteristic of patients, the natural evolution of the disease, the placebo effect, the regression to the mean, the Hawthorne effect, the concomitant treatments, the measurement errors. There is a lot of factors that may explain the response to treatment. And we like also randomization, The randomization is from a pool of eligible patients who accept to enter in a trial. Subjects are randomly assigned to each of the intervention and non-intervention groups. And in fact, there is one major advantage of randomization that is shared by no other technique. The advantage is to produce groups that are similar, even with respect to variables that we have not anticipated, not defined, or not measured. If the group of patients randomized is large, randomization is the best way to make study groups comparable and to control for known, that is quite easy, and unknown confounding factors. But even if we have at the beginning of the trial two comparable groups, we need also to maintain the comparability of groups during the study. And for that, we need blinding. And we like that the patient, the healthcare teams, and the outcome assessor must be as much as possible be kept unaware of the received treatment to maintain the comparability of the group over time. We use different units of randomization, and it's quite different, I think, in medicine in contrast to other areas. Randomization of individuals, and probably 95% of our randomized control trials are randomization with individuals as unit of randomization. But we do also randomization of cluster of individuals, but it's only 5% of our randomized control trials. The random units could be hospitals, wards, physicians, schools, families, households, villages. And the type of intervention studied are intervention administered to health professionals or intervention is when there is a risk of contamination between arms, but also we use cluster randomized control trials for contagious disease. In fact, you must have a good reason for randomizing cluster rather than individuals. And Alan Doller, the big specialist of cluster randomized control trials in medicine, say avoid this design whenever possible because it's more complicated and more difficult from a methodological point of view. Now, a few examples explaining why randomized control trials are so useful. The first example is about estrogens. In the 80s and 90s, researchers published numerous epidemiologic studies showing that estrogen replacement therapy for menopausal women lowered their risk of heart attacks. And according to this study, the reduction was by more than 50%. And the protective effect of estrogen seemed to make perfect biological sense. There is an hormone deprivation, it seems logical to replace this hormone. In addition, estrogen improves vasomotor symptoms and decreases bone fragility in short-term randomized controlled trials. And millions of menopausal women were treated over the world with hormone therapy, and more than 5 million in the US as an example. And a randomized control trial was proposed to confirm the heart benefit, but was considered as unethical by some physicians, and there was editorials in journals against this trial. And this trial, the Woman Health Initiative Estrogen plus Progestin clinical trials, was launched. And 16,000 menopausal women were recruited and randomly assigned to estrogen plus progesterone or placebo. And it was one of the most expensive randomized controlled trials ever funded by the National Institute of Health in USA. The cost was $260 million. And this trial has to be stopped because the findings of this trial demonstrate the risk of this treatment. In fact, there was no decrease of the risk of heart disease, but an increase of the risk of heart disease, but also an increase of the risk of stroke and also of breast cancer. And recently, an American paper published the economic return from this trial, and this trial resulted in USA over a period of 10 years in 4.3 million fewer hormone therapy users, 126,000 fewer breast cancer cases, 76,000 fewer cardiovascular disease cases, and 263,000 more fractures. And the corresponding net economic return of the trial was $37 billion, $140 per dollar invested in the trial. Therefore, we like performing trials. Overall, there is approximately in the field of health 450,000 existing randomized controlled trials since the beginning of the 60s. And there is 25,000 randomized controlled trials performed each year, half of them for evaluating pharmacological treatment and half of them for non-pharmacological treatment, complex intervention. For example, physiotherapy, devices, surgery, behavioral interventions. The number of included patients per randomized controlled trials is from 50 to 20,000, and the cost of one randomized controlled trial could be from $100,000 to $400 million. And performing randomized controlled trials is a global enterprise. These trials are performed by industry or non-industry sponsor. Approximately 30% of trials are industry sponsored. And on this slide, you could see the size of the node is proportional to the number of trials per million inhabitants in each country. The color of the node represents the collaborative ratio of the country, blue representing 100% of trials conducted at single country trials, and red, 100% international trials. And as you could see, basically, the industry perform international trials and the non-industry perform single country trials because we are unable to organize trials with a center in different countries for insurance issues and so on. Now the pitfalls of randomized controlled trials. The main pitfalls is that the external validity and applicability of randomized controlled trial results may be limited. People in trials are different from people in the real world, patient. In trials, patients are known to be highly selected and not representative of the patient treated in clinical practice. Center of physicians are not really representative of real world. For example, in surgery, the trials are performed most of the time in high-volume centers, and we know that the results of high-volume centers are better than the results of low-volume centers in the field of surgery. And interventions are, in most cases, better standardized in randomized controlled trials. Sometimes the choice of outcomes is questionable. We frequently use surrogate marker instead of clinically relevant outcomes, but it's more we use now clinically relevant outcomes. The choice of the comparator could be questionable, and people think that sometimes that randomized controlled trials are too slow and too costly. To illustrate the question of applicability, it's a graphical representation of the world, but the area cartogram shows the size of the country in proportion of the number of smokers. And as you could see, there is a lot of smokers in India, China, all the Asia, and Russia, and also in the Middle East. And in contrast, if you have the area cartogram showing the size of this country in proportion to the number of trials performed or ongoing to aim at evaluating intervention to stop tobacco use, you could see that all these trials are performed in USA and in Western Europe, and a little bit in Australia. And in fact, we could ask if trials performed in USA could inform decisions in India or China. Therefore, it's clear that we have some problem for applicability and mainly for complex intervention. Another pitfall of randomized controlled trials is that the prioritization of trials is not optimal. We don't have enough trials for important questions, and we are a lot of trials that are conducted to address low priority questions. And the last point is that the number of randomized controlled trials to answer all existing questions will be too high. For example, if for a disease we have 15 different possible treatments, it would suppose to conduct 105 randomized controlled trials to obtain at least one direct comparison for all available treatment, and it's clearly impossible to do. Therefore, we have some troubles with the prioritization of the trial to choose the best, the most useful trials. In fact, high quality of evidence based on randomized control trials is quite scarce in some area. Here is an example about the clinical practice guideline used and the scientific evidence underlying these guidelines. It's guidelines from the American College of Cardiology, the most important scientific society of cardiology in North America. And you could see here that we have the grading of each guideline based for different disease or different devices, for example, for pacemaker or for atrial fibrillation, heart failure, stable angina, unstable angina. And we have the grading of recommendation. A is a recommendation based on randomized controlled trial, and C is a recommendation based on expert opinion. And as you could see, the percentage of recommendation based on randomized controlled trials is quite low. For example, for atrial fibrillation is something like 10%, or for heart failure is something like 25%. And most depressing, in my view, you have 2 points in time. For example, for fibrillary atriation, we have 1 point in 2001 and one in 2006. And there is no improvement over time. Therefore, the proportion of recommendation with high evidence levels has not increased over time. Therefore, we have to think differently about trials, and we are working to modify a little bit the trial we are performing. First, we are working on simplifying trials. We are developing now large, simple trials, low-cost, real-world, or pragmatic trials. I could come back to this term, pragmatic trials, because this term was firstly introduced by Schwartz and Lelouch 50 years ago in a paper in the Journal of Chronic Disease, and this paper was mostly ignored during 40 years. And 10 years ago, this paper was republished in Statistical in Medicine and in the Journal of Clinical Epidemiology, and now all people in the world are thinking to perform pragmatic trials. We move from efficacy trials that are trials performed in the best position with selected patient and with selected intervention to pragmatic trials closer to the real world. We are also working on disruptive approaches to perform more trials and to integrate trials into the care of patient. We are performing now clinically integrated trials, direct-to-patient trials, point-of-care cluster randomized trials, or cohort-embedded randomized control trials. After the trials, systematic reviews. We use also a lot of systematic reviews. Systematic reviews are used because, as said by Cindy Mulrow, that was deputy editor of Annals of Internal Medicine, large quantities of information must be reduced into palatable pieces for decision. It's impossible for people to deal with all the literature. Science is cumulative, and scientists should cumulate scientifically. And the process of cumulation, information synthesis, should use methods to reduce biases and the play of chance. Therefore, we use systematic reviews with some key characteristics, explicit and reproducible methodology. It's research, therefore we have to perform a research protocol that is registered before beginning the systematic review. We need to perform a systematic search that attempts to identify all studies that meet predefined eligibility criteria. We have to assess of the validity of the findings of the included studies. And we have to perform a systematic presentation and synthesis of the characteristics and findings of the included studies. Therefore, when we have a series of randomized control trials, we could perform what we call first a systematic review and then a meta-analysis. And meta-analysis is a statistical technique for combining the results of independent but similar studies to obtain an overall estimate of treatment effect. With this meta-analysis, we obtain the pool effect estimate by synthesis of trials. And here is an example of meta-analysis about the corticosteroid for treating severe sepsis and septic shock. You have the list of the studies. We have the data about all the studies. You have here the treatment effect estimate for each of the study. And here a graphical representation that we call a forest plot with all the study and a measurement of uncertainty for each study. And here we add what we call the risk of bias tool, and we know for each of this study for different parameters that are considered as at risk of bias. If there is a high risk of bias in red, an increased risk of bias in yellow, or a low risk of bias in green. Therefore, for each study, we know the risk of bias of this study, and we could perform sensitivity analysis by eliminating the risk, the studies at high risk of bias. Therefore, now people think that systematic review are very important, and here is, for example, an editorial from K. Dickerson from the U.S. Cochrane Center, saying that to reform U.S. Healthcare start with systematic review. And before initiating the new research, a formal synthesis of currently available knowledge should determine whether it's necessary or not. Cochrane collaboration is deeply involved in the field of meta-analysis and systematic review. It's an international organization founded in 1993 in Oxford. The aim of this collaboration is to help researchers, physicians, policymakers, consumers to make well-informed decisions about healthcare. How? By preparing, maintaining, and promoting the accessibility of systematic review on the effects of healthcare intervention. It's a not-for-profit organization funded by a variety of sources, including governments, universities, hospital trusts, and charities. And it's completely independent from pharmaceutical companies. It's seen as an essential component of evidence-based medicine and health policy. Overall, there is more than 500 paid staff in the Cochrane and 28,000 volunteers around the world, review authors and peer reviewers, and these volunteers come from 100 countries. The organization is quite complex. There is 14 national Cochrane centers and multiple branches in different countries. There is 54 review groups by disease or by domains working quite exclusively on one specific domain, for example, perinatal disease. And there is 10 fields that are such as vaccination or emergency if some reviews concern multiple review groups. And there is also 14 methodological groups. For example, there is a group dedicated to the risk of bias, to how to assess the risk of bias of trials. And you could see the geographical dispersion of these centers and branches. And here is the 54 groups. These groups are quite different in their size. The size of the group is related to the number of reviews performed by the groups. And some groups are very big and some groups are very small. And here you have an area cartogram showing the size of the countries in proportion to the number of Cochrane entities. And in fact, it's quite clear that UK is very important in the Cochrane, and Australia also, South Africa, and a little bit North America, but it's less developed in other countries. But it's quite, there is some modification in the next few years. The Cochrane collaboration produced over than 5,500 systematic reviews, approximately 800 per year. And the Cochrane produced this review according to the same standardized and rigorous process. We follow the same method precisely described. We have a book, the Cochrane Handbook for Systematic Reviews, with the same peer review process at the protocol stage and before publication, with a standardized reporting and using a dedicated software developed by the Cochrane. And there is also other output from the Cochrane. We train people all over the world to perform systematic review on meta-analysis. We are the leaders in terms of methodology and statistical development for systematic review on meta-analysis, and a lot of the methodological innovation developed by the Cochrane are now used by all people performing systematic review on meta-analysis. And the Cochrane maintain the Cochrane library with several databases, a database of Cochrane review, but also a big registry of all randomized control trials in the world, and multiple other databases about all existing materials in the field. Now the threats for the validity of meta-analysis. We know that including biased randomized control trials will cause meta-analysis to be biased. Therefore, as we know that approximately 50% of randomized control trials are at high risk of bias, we have to deal with that. But the major threats to the validity of systematic reviews are publication and reporting biases. And if the sample of studies retrieved for the review is biased, then the validity of the results of a meta-analytic review is threatened, no matter how systematic and thorough in other respects. We know that finding all published studies is usually easy, but finding all relevant studies is almost impossible. All unpublished trials and the grey literature. Therefore, our major issue is to find all studies performed in a specific area. Here is an example about the public availability of the results of trials assessing cancer drugs in the United States. And as you could see on this slide, only 60% of the trials were available 3 years after their completion. There is 40% of the trials that are not published and their results are not available. Another example of the issue about publication bias is a paper published by Eric Turner, who was a psychiatrist working at the Food and Drug Administration, about the selective publication of antidepressant trials. In this study performed by Eric Turner, he studied 12 antidepressant drugs using a cohort of 74 trials about this drug. These trials were submitted to the Food and Drug Administration for the approval of this drug. He tracked each trial into published literature, and for each trial, he had two questions. Was the trial published? And if published, how did the published results compare with the FDA results? Because the FDA reanalyzed systematically the data. And he performed two separate meta-analyses for each drug, one for the FDA dataset and one using the journal dataset, the published data. And here you have the results. 74 trials were registered to the FDA, but there was only 51 matching publications. Therefore, 23 trials were not published. And using the meta-analysis, it showed that the increase in effect size ranged from 11 to 69% for individual drugs and was 32% overall. Therefore, if you use published articles only, you overestimate by 32% the efficacy of these antidepressant drugs. And more interestingly, we have here the presentation of the studies according to the FDA decision, according to the analysis performed by the FDA. For the trials classified as positive trials by the FDA, 38 trials, only one trial was not published. 37 were published. On the negative trials, according to the FDA, 24 trials, 3 were published, 16 were not published, and 5 were published, but with results conflicting with the analysis of the FDA. In fact, it was analysis that was not consistent with the data. Another example is about a drug that is called oseltamivir, better known as Tamiflu, and it was a long history for the Cochrane, because the first Cochrane review about this drug in 2006, performed by Tom Jefferson, The conclusion of this Cochrane review was, in healthy adults, Tamiflu daily is effective in preventing lower respiratory tract complications in influenza cases. And it was a nice protection with an odds ratio of 0.32, and it was quite a good drug. And in 2009, Jefferson published a new Cochrane review, and he wrote, the remaining published evidence is insufficient to answer the question about the effectiveness of reducing the complication of lower respiratory tract infection, antibiotic use, or admission to hospital. We are no longer sure that oseltamivir offers a therapeutic and public health policy advantage over cheap drugs such as aspirin. In fact, there was 10 manufacturers-funded trials, of which only two were published in peer-reviewed journals, and the major trial with 10,000 patients were not published. And Roche, the pharmaceutical company, publicly promised independent scientists to give access to full study reports of Tamiflu trials, but the company has not made even one full report available 5 years later. And the majority of Roche phase 3 treatment trials remain unpublished over a decade after completion of these trials. And the British Medical Journal launched an open data campaign appealing Roche to make the full clinical study reports available with papers and articles every month in the British Medical Journal for obtaining this data. And in 2013, Roche gives the data, and Tom Jefferson published in 2014 a new Cochrane review. The updated Cochrane review is based on full internal reports of 20 Tamiflu and Relenza trials involving more than 24,000 people. The findings challenge the historical assumption that these drugs are effective in combating influenza. The review confirms small benefits on symptoms relief, namely shortening duration of symptoms by half a day on average. However, there is little evidence to support any belief that use of these drugs reduce hospital admission or the risk of developing confirmed pneumonia. And the question is now the cost of this hidden data. According to Fiona Goodley, editor-in-chief of BMG, this review is the result of many years of struggles to access and use trial data, which was previously unpublished and even hidden from view. And it outlines with certainty that future decisions to purchase and use drugs, particularly when on a mass scale, must be based on a complete picture of the evidence, both published and unpublished. And according to Karim Abazi, the international editor of the BMG, over $20 billion of public money has been spent on stockpiling drugs of uncertain benefit, and decisions were based on incomplete data. But I would like to say that it's clearly this publication bias not specific to research performed by pharmaceutical companies and not specific to health research. Is a work published in Science last summer about the publication bias in social science. It was about 221 social science experiments funded by the National Science Foundation, academic research. And as you could see on this slide, if you have strong results, most of this work is published in good journals or in top journals or in good journals, or is written, and very few is unwritten. If you have null results, a lot of the work is unwritten and very few papers are published. Therefore, clearly, it's not only the pharmaceutical company, but it's all researchers that are responsible for this publication bias. And experiments with negative results are as important as experiments with positive results. Therefore, we try to work to prevent this publication bias, and it's a major challenge for us. And a lot have been done in the field of healthcare to prevent this publication bias. The first thing is that we try to prevent the lack of publication of a trial. And for that, we have a prospective registration of all studies in the world at inception, before the inclusion of the first patient. And the Food and Drug Administration Amendment Act and the EU directive are also very important, and I will come later on this point. And we try also to prevent incomplete reporting, and for that we perform what we call reporting guidelines to describe what to report systematically for each publication. The first point is that trial in the field of health, trial registration is mandatory since 2005. It was initially a decision of the International Committee of Medical Journal Editors, and since 2005, a clinical trial that is not registered could not be published anymore. And the aim of this registry is to ensure that a complete view of research is accessible to all those in healthcare decision making. And all registries of trials meet specific criteria for content, validity, and accessibility. They must be publicly available. And for each trial, we have a list of 20 main items of the protocol that are registered before the beginning of the trial. And we have a unique identification of the number per trial. And we have a platform, a WHO platform, and it's a central database containing the trial registration dataset provided by all national registries. The American one, that is the biggest one, maintained by the National Library of Medicine. It's clinicaltrial.gov. And there is, in clinicaltrial.gov, 180,000 studies registered. And we have also data from the EU registry, Indian registry, Thai registry, Cuban, and so on. And these databases are updated weekly for the biggest one and monthly for the other. Therefore, we could obtain very easily the data for all trials performed in the world, even it's a Chinese trial, or even it's a Japanese trial, or Iranian trial, we have access to the data. For example, I am able in a few seconds to obtain all the trials performed on the drug, rituximab, and there is 1,385 registered trials, including 435 completed trials. And I know exactly where in the world these trials are performed. And I could have access to the main items of the protocol of these trials. Very interestingly also, we have since 2007 in US, the US federal law that enacted the mandatory registration on results, on results reporting for clinical trials of drugs, biological products, and devices. And these results must be reported at clinicaltrial.gov. Therefore, study sponsor or PI are required to report summary results information within 1 year of completing data collection. And in case of non-compliance, could result in penalties up to $10,000 a day and the withholding of NIH grant funding. But it's these apply to industry, but also to academic researchers. And it's independent of publication in journals. Even if you have published in journals, you have to send your results to clinicaltrial.gov. And according to this law, we need to have for each arm the description of the participant flow, the baseline characteristic of patient, a table of results for the primary and secondary outcome with appropriate statistical analysis, the frequency of all serious adverse events, and the frequency of other adverse events grouped by organ system. Therefore, we have a lot of data that are posted on clinicaltrial.gov. And we have a required template to fill, and we have a lot of information for each trial when this trial is terminated. Interestingly, we compare published trials with posted results of these trials, and the completeness of reporting is better in clinicaltrial.gov rather than in the published article. We have more information in clinicaltrial.gov than in the published article for the same trials. And for example, we have much more information about serious adverse events and about adverse events. And now we will have the same regulation in Europe, and this new legislation will come into effect in 2016. This regulation requires that a summary of the results from all trials with an EU site must be posted on a register within a year of the trial's end. Therefore, we will have the information for all trials with one site in USA or in Europe and with the result posted. We think also that it's very difficult to perform a meta-analysis based only on the publication performed from trials, because it's a huge work to perform a trial, but at the end we have only a publication that is something like 5 or 6 pages. Therefore, we think that there is a lot of other information that are relevant. And there is now a new collaborative open database that will be launched in the next few years, trying to collect all available information on all clinical trials. And the intention is to create an open, freely reusable index of all information to facilitate research. Now, for each individual trial, this open link database will be designed to host and match all the following documents: the registries entries, but also the text of academic journal paper, all the regulatory documents, clinical study reports, statistical reports from FDA and European Medical Agency, trial paperwork, case report forms, protocols, consent forms, statistical analysis plans, and structured data on methods and results extracted by systematic reviewers. Therefore, we will have on a unique repository all the information on a trial. We are also working to prevent incomplete reporting, and because we know that for a lot of trials there is an incomplete or incorrect description of methods or results. And for that, there is an international organization called Equator for enhancing the quality and transparency of health research. Therefore, the first pitfall of systematic review on meta-analysis is publication bias. But there is another question about systematic review on meta-analysis. I am not completely sure that we really address the question of interest for physicians. The question of interest for physicians is what is the best treatment for this condition. It's not did this treatment work, is what is the best treatment for this condition. The first point is that there is frequently no or few head-to-head trials, therefore direct comparison between treatments are frequently lacking, resulting in empty meta-analysis or inconclusive evidence. And the last point is that the meta-analysis process is very time-consuming, and meta-analyses are never systematically updated as soon as new evidence becomes available. Therefore, here is the example of evidence missing from systematic review based on the example of lung cancer. We perform from 2009 to 2015 each year a systematic review of the evidence covered by systematic review, and as you could see, 30 to 58% of patients were missing, 40 to 66% of treatment were missing, 38 to 71% of comparison were missing. In fact, there is not always all the patient, all the treatment, and all the comparisons that are used in systematic review performed. Therefore, I think that we have to move from meta-analysis to network meta-analysis. In meta-analysis, the question we ask is, does treatment A work for condition X? Is A better than B? And in network meta-analysis, the question is quite different. Among all treatments available for condition X, A, B, C, D, E treatment, which one is the best? And here you have the graphical representation of that. There is 5 drugs, A, B, C, D, E. You have the trials comparing A to E, A to B, A to C, A to D. And what we could do in a network meta-analysis is to have pooled effect estimate for all possible comparison between treatments by synthesis or direct and indirect evidence. Even if you don't have direct trials between B and C, you could take advantage of the trial between A and C and the trial between A and B to obtain indirect evidence for that. And here is the network that offers a wider picture than a single traditional meta-analysis. Here you have all the trials for advanced cancer treatment. And as you could see, there's a lot of different treatments. And here the size of each node is proportional to the amount of information, the sample size of the trial. And the size of this line is proportional to the number of trials. Therefore, we could perform quantitative synthesis on combining direct and indirect information, permitting to obtain all possible pairwise comparison between treatments. And at the end, we obtain such an unreadable table with all the treatment and all the comparison between treatment with a treatment effect. And it's the first step. But the second step is that we have to move from network meta-analysis to real-time cumulative network meta-analysis. And we are working on the proof of concept on that. In fact, the good question for the patient and the physician is, among all treatments available for condition X, in September 2015, which one is the best? And the idea is to perform an initial network meta-analysis and at short regular intervals to redo, partially automatically, the whole process of NMA, searching new trials, updating the network of trials, extracting data, assessing risk of bias tool, and reanalyzing data every 2 months or 3 months, something like that. But it's not already done, but it's clearly the future of meta-analysis. And my last point is that clearly I have talked about randomized control trial and I have talked about meta-analysis, but there is other sources of evidence. And evidence-based medicine is not only randomized control trials. And we use also now big administrative database. Here is a slide from Patrick Ryan based on a consortium of people working on administrative database. And as he said, his mother-in-law was treated by metformin for diabetes. It's a quite old drug. And there is 141 patients exposed in pivotal randomized clinical trial for metformin. And in fact, in administrative database, we have data about more than 1 million new users of metformin in only one American administrative claim database. Therefore, we could also obtain a lot of information of this database, for example, for side effects of drugs and things like that. In conclusion, randomized control trials on meta-analysis are invaluable means to assess the effect of intervention in healthcare. Our methods are not perfect, but the arguments against randomized control trials or meta-analysis would discredit any other form of evaluation even more than randomized control trials or meta-analysis. And transparency of health research remains far from perfect, even if major advances have been achieved over the last 10 years. And we need to improve the organization of the medical research community to address the needs of patients, physicians, and decision makers, because we have thousands of questions to answer, and we need to answer this question in a timely fashion. Thank you. I want to acknowledge the member of my team. And yes, like that. In fact, we don't have any other option than evidence-based medicine in the field of medicine.
Merci, Professeur RAVAUD.